I typically try to cover movies, TV shows, and games that I love for Unscripted, mainly because I don't like trashing on anyone's work for an extended period of time. I'm a generally upbeat person, but I always think media has room to improve. That's what this is for. But this video and the next are just quick opinion pieces on some trends that I've seen recently that might risk the quality of scripts, or even negate the need for writers in general. I knew I had to be really careful picking my first case study. I watch a lot of mediocre or lazy movies and television, but nothing that truly fills the requirement of culturally impactful enough to warrant calling dangerous to storytelling, let alone a show that has something genuinely worth griping over. I can't tell you how many times films just come and go each year with no fanfare. Big and small, they're just considered trite, boring, non-compelling, too long, or any other buzzword that slims down millions of dollars and thousands of hours and hundreds of employees down to a light shrug in a casual conversation. But then I saw Stranger Things for the third time. I mean, Stranger Things Season 3. Something technically superior in visuals and scale and in brand recognition than the last season, but with nothing new to say. Everything I could discuss about the show is just so surface level. Everything the show is about can be seen at face value. A group of outcast kids meet a new girl with supernatural powers and come together as they take down a supernatural threat that could destroy the whole town. That baseline description has been copied and pasted so many times since the era this show mimics, but there's nothing to add in character nuance or development from that point. Or at least the Duffer brothers chose not to. I still like the show, don't get me wrong. It's incredibly accessible and easily digestible enough to just put on like your 10th rewatch of The Office. The unoriginality, or rather homage, isn't necessarily a setback. The iconography and the familiarity was something originally planned all the way back to the pitch Bible. This is one of the few openly available examples online of early show Bibles that people pitched to studios to inform them of their idea in a fleshed out way, in hopes of getting it picked up. Even here, many of the characters' names and personalities are the same to what we eventually see on screen. P.S. Will Byers is gay, confirmed. The Duffer brothers had a strong understanding of their characters and knew that creating something familiar would both allow them and the audience to strongly focus on the characters. However, that iconography soon became intertwined with the characters, in that the audience felt so connected to the product as a whole that I believe preserving these elements became centerfold. One of my favorite videos I've done talked about six-act narrative structure in hour-long dramas, using CW's The Flash as an example. I broke down the difference between a show that's a series, or episodic, versus serialized, the latter meaning a show that has an ongoing storyline from one episode to the next, and characters grow and change as a result of this, whereas sitcoms, or series, tend to share a few common traits. Each episode is primarily self-contained, each episode strictly follows a three-act structure as opposed to the whole season. While plot arcs can move across episodes, there's always resolution after each. Some examples including Seinfeld, Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, Saved by the Bell, and Friends. The main issue with these is that characters follow the same rigid guideline. Coming from Alex Epstein's book, Crafty TV Writing, characters rarely develop in TV. If your characters change, the dynamic between them changes. The conflicts between your characters should be an endless source of stories. If those conflicts get resolved, you've removed a source of dramatic conflict. That means you've just lost a source of stories. There's a lot of clear overlap between the two forms of storytelling, and modern sitcoms are blurring that line further, seen primarily in shows like Atlanta and BoJack Horseman. But with serialized shows, more often than not, the driving force behind the plots are the changing and developing cast of characters that keep them going. In sitcoms, it's common to see reliance on established archetypes for characters to make up for the time limit and plot restrictions of a 22-minute episode. And so comes the risk of Flanderization, coined from popular Simpsons character and my dad's doppelganger, Ned Flanders. Whereas nuance and simplicity in character was slowly cut out until eventually he was just an over-the-top caricature, a representation of what the audience pictured him to be and not what he actually was. The settings and scenarios in Stranger Things have become heightened versions of what they already were. Instead of one monster, it's like 100. Instead of four kids, there's like 7. This more mentality could inevitably raise the stakes and increase the drama between the characters, putting them in new and more challenging scenarios, but instead these characters remain the same. That's not to say they don't appear to change. They get in relationships, they fight, They hang out with different people, but any development seems to halt before it can cement itself. Hopper dies before he and Joyce can act on their feelings. Mike is told off for being a selfish dick, but doesn't really absolve himself of it before coming back to fight the monster. Steve just adopts 5 children out of circumstance. And that last bit, while adding to his character, still feels like the story existing in 2 pools. He's just responsible for them. He doesn't change them, really. The most important thesis of this last season was Will's desperate trying to hold on to his friends and childhood. But after that great outburst, the plotline is dropped into the last 20 minutes of the finale. So it just feels all so rushed. All character arc progressions appear contrived then, and their resolutions leave the audience with a feeling like they aren't finalized. They're unearned. The overall feeling of the state of character seems like with each season, the writers start the characters in the middle of a small box, and allow them to explore that box of character traits without breaking out to get some real development. Even when they start to, the next season's box is just a scenario that best serves the plot, without much different or challenging other than things that shake up the status quo, other than childhood breakups and day-to-day minutia.
I dump your ass.
In the past seasons, characterization came with this forward momentum in the story. We learned about the characters as the plot unfolded, and the characters helped each other learn new and different information, feeding off of each other's plot lines. But here, the characters all seem to exist in this neutral state where everything is business as usual. There is clearly effort to push these characters forward, but they act like they don't want to, and so they don't. There's not resistance, which would be more interesting and on theme like with Will Byers. There's just indifference. It's time for the show to grow, without fear that fans would abandon what made the show so successful in the first place. A serialized plot with episodic-type characters creates this weird gap between a show that's entertaining fluff and something that can truly leave an emotional impact. I fear the golden age of television might come to an abrupt end when these massive hits start prioritizing longevity above making the time we have with them actually worthwhile. That's pretty much all I had to say on Stranger Things. Just a quick examination of where I believe things are going with the show, and my hopes and fears for what the recently teased season 4 would have in store. In the next video, I'll be talking about something a bit more substantial, even though its impact has been suitably much more small scale. It's gonna be a fun one. Let's just hope you're not completely lost and baffled by the end like me. If anything, I hope these next couple of videos help you start thinking about television and storytelling from a meta perspective as well, and help you start thinking about how you might shape your own stories to counteract this. Or feed into it. You do you. See y'all next week.